What if I told you that your fridge, that humming box in the kitchen, could be cooled without gas, without chemicals, and just magnets? It sounds futuristic, but researchers and companies are already making it happen. It not only promises higher efficiency, but solves a critical problem with the status quo. Yes, a critical problem that even my beloved heat pumps have. The thing is, we need an alternative to refrigerants. Caloric cooling is one alternative, and one US research team claims that magnetocalorics in particular are already on their way to replacing our current coolants with systems that are much more attractive. But how do you control the temperature with a solid material rather than a refrigerant gas? And what makes magnetocalorics stand out? And is this cooling tech solid enough to redefine what it means to be a fridge magnet? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Incogni. Magnetocalorics may not be mainstream, but they're not moving at a glacial pace. A few new commercial products have already hit the market that cool with magnets. One German company is already selling a beverage cooler and offering pre-orders for a two-door commercial refrigerator. At the end of last year, you could grab yourself a drink out of a functioning fridge displayed by a French-German company at a heating and cooling technology trade fair. And shortly after that, a major update came from the Ames National Laboratory in the US that kicked off our investigation into this topic. This is our second dive into the world of caloric cooling, so if you caught our earlier video on elastocalorics, some of this might ring a bell. But I promise there's a very big material difference here. Instead of stretching the limits of refrigeration tech, today we'll be talking about how researchers have been throwing magnets at the wall to see what sticks. The vapor compression cycle behind our freezers and HVAC systems is centuries old. At its core, it's all about phase changes. Nature's clever trick that lets 5 billion heat pumps, fridges, and ACs shuffle heat around to keep us comfortable. But as elegant as that system is, it relies heavily on refrigerants, mostly hydrofluorocarbons, or HFCs, that change phase throughout the cycle. As you probably know, HFCs come with some serious environmental baggage. It's clear our approach to climate control could use an upgrade, and swapping refrigerants for magnets might be just the retooling that we need. To understand the greater study of caloric cooling, we first have to understand what we're working with. If you weren't around for our first exploration into caloric effects, or maybe your memory just vaporized, here's a compressed refresher. Our current generation of cooling units, whether it's a window AC or an old school icebox, are all heat exchangers. And a heat exchanger is just a machine that moves heat from a hotter place to a cooler one. Most cooling devices rely on four main components: a compressor, condenser, expander, and evaporator. And these make up the vapor compression cycle, which breaks down into four key steps. First up is the compressor. It boosts the temperature and the pressure of the refrigerant vapor. Then the condenser kicks in, turning that vapor into a liquid, releasing heat in the process. Next, the expander drops the pressure of the refrigerant. As it expands, it cools down, colder than the space that we want to chill. Finally, the evaporator absorbs heat from the surrounding area, vaporizing the refrigerant. And just like that, the cycle repeats with the compressor grabbing that warm vapor and starting all over again. Now you can confidently explain how your fridge works, which is perfect for the next time you need a cool icebreaker. But this method is everywhere. Given that vapor compression dates back to the 19th century, it's fair to say our refrigerators have been running strong for a long time. So how could magnets possibly catch up and improve on that? Well, before we flip the polarity on traditional cooling, let's take a quick break, because while magnets might solve one kind of problem, today's sponsor tackles a very different one. I was stuck under a massive amount of unwanted spam messages for a long time. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Well, today's sponsor, Incogni, can help you get to the source of the problem and restore some of your privacy. As my wife and I were getting our house constructed, setting up loans, getting insurance, and everything else that you have to do when you're moving, I saw a major uptick in the amount of spam and promotional emails I was getting. I'm sure you've experienced this kind of thing too. That happened because companies sold my information to data brokers, and sometimes they sell your info to some pretty shady people. Incogni can help you with this. We have the right to request the data brokers delete our information, but it takes a lot of time and effort. I signed up for Incogni, gave them the legal right to work on my behalf, and then just sat back and relaxed. You'll see updates on your account for which data brokers they've sent legal requests to and which ones have complied. It couldn't be easier. If you want to take back some control around who has access to your personal information, give Incogni a try. Take your personal data back with Incogni. Use code UNDECIDED at the link below and get 60% off an annual plan. Thanks to Incogni and to all of you for supporting the channel. All right, now that we've handled the data overload, let's get back to the thermal overload. Magnetocalorics, or magnetic cooling, have been an ongoing field of study for researchers interested in dumping refrigerants, or maybe no longer having to worry about the consequences of dumping refrigerants. Anyway, scientists have tinkered with the concept of magnetic refrigeration for decades. The reason why magnetocalorics is suddenly attracting attention, however, is partly due to the recent prototypes that researchers claim have achieved parity with existing vapor compression cycles. So how is this possible? Well, lucky for us, this process can also be broken down into four steps, just like the vapor compression cycle. In fact, all forms of caloric cooling parallel the vapor compression cycle. A hypothetical HVAC based on caloric effects would effectively be substituting refrigerants for any material when manipulated that changes temperature. You start with a caloric material, which could be anything from rubber to ceramic, as opposed to a gaseous refrigerant. Then you apply force. Seriously. In our previous video on the topic, I showed off the elastocaloric effect, which is based on mechanically stressing, or in other words, bending, a material like these nitinol wires. And guess what, kids? You can try this at home. Just like refrigerants, elastocaloric materials undergo phase changes that alternatively cool them down and heat them up. But caloric cooling doesn't always need physical force. As opposed to mechanical stress, electrocaloric devices expose certain materials to electric fields so they can change phases. And you can probably tell where I'm going with this. Magnetocalorics involves subjecting the right kind of material to a magnetic field to accomplish the same exact thing. So what is the right kind of material? Well, magnetocaloric cooling may be a marvel, but we won't be needing any telepathy-blocking helmets to get the desired effect. Store-bought magnetism is fine. Let me introduce you to gadolinium, neutron poison, friend radiologist, and the 64th element in the periodic table. While you might already know the metal for its applications in keeping nuclear reactors under control and scanning our brains, it also has the potential to develop into something that's a lot more, well, domestic. That's because gadolinium is one blade in our magnetocaloric multi-tool. In other words, gadolinium is one of the most common materials that these devices can apply magnetic fields to. So what does that look like in practice? Well, I'll answer that question by taking you through the inner workings of a device that's newly developed by the US Department of Energy Ames National Laboratory. In December of 2024, the Iowa State University research team, led by Julie Slaughter, announced the completion of a magnetocaloric heat pump, or MCHP, that they claim can match current vapor compression heat pumps for weight, cost, and performance. For this particular iteration, the research team studied the magnetocaloric effects of both gadolinium and lofisi, an alloy of lanthanum, iron, and silicon. We'll get into why lofisi matters later, though, but to start, the Ames lab team created their baseline device using gadolinium. So let's map out exactly where and how it does its thing. Inside the middle of the heat pump's cylindrical housing lies the active magnetic regenerator, or AMR. Now, if you're not familiar, don't let the acronym intimidate you, like it did me initially. A regenerator is just another type of heat exchanger in the broader family tree. What makes regenerators different than other types of heat exchangers is that both the hot and cold streams cross over the same paths, but their goal is the same as any other: get the heat away from the hot area and bring it to the colder one. As for what active magnetic means, well, the basic concept is that magnetic material plays two roles, as both the foundation of the regenerator and the stand-in for the refrigerant itself. The Ames model AMR consists of 9 beds arranged into a ring. The AMR is porous, not unlike a foam mattress actually. These hold a bunch of tightly packed gadolinium particles, each only about 200 microns across, so about the size of a very fine coffee ground. At the start of the regenerative cycle, these particles are demagnetized, or more precisely, they're not yet magnetized. They're just kind of asleep in their beds. And speaking of coffee, you know how some people can't function in the morning until they've had their coffee? Well, if you think about it, you could call coffee a working fluid. It's definitely conducive to working. Magnetocaloric devices just tend to prefer a steaming cup of water instead, typically with a little shot of something extra for practical flavor. The Ames prototype will have its working fluid with one pump of anti-corrosion agent, please. Or at least that's what lead author Julie Slaughter confirmed via email. Now, while I don't think you'll be able to order this drink off of a secret menu anytime soon, it gets a very important job done. It flows into the AMR beds hot and ready to begin the cooling process. Even with a don't even talk to me until mug in hand, the gadolinium particles are still disorderly. To jolt them upright and activate them, you need a magnetic field. That's where a set of permanent magnets step in. And by step in, I really mean spin in, because in the Ames heat pump, these magnets are set into a central circuit that rotates. As they pass by each stationary AMR bed, the gadolinium magnetizes and gets hot. Then as the magnetic field moves over the next bed, that array is no longer exposed to it and it loses magnetization. This causes the gadolinium temperature to drop and get cold, similar to what happens when you depressurize a gas refrigerant in a traditional compressor. From there, the working fluid cools, then moves to the hotter end of the heat pump's internal core. The setup demagnetizes and the cycle starts again for the individual bed, that is. The cool thing about this arrangement is that because the magnets are rotating, they're constantly magnetizing and demagnetizing each bed in turn, and therefore alternatively heating and cooling them off. Here's what it looks like in action. Of course, the Ames lab research team did not invent this specific approach. In fact, the other magnetocaloric devices that we're going to show off in this video work using a rotating circuit. The focus of Ames' study wasn't the design of the prototype, it was the optimization. Remember that other magnetocaloric material, LaFisai? Once the researchers got the initial design with the gadolinium down pat, the goal was to improve the system power density, or SPD. As explained in the paper, SPD is the thermal power in watts divided by device mass in kilograms, which is a quick way to compare magnetocaloric heat pumps with compressors. So power divided by mass, or basically bang for your buck. After all, it isn't that magnetocaloric heat pumps haven't been proven to work. It's that, just like earlier iterations of computers, they're currently too big and therefore too expensive for home use. Less bulk, less price. Part of Ames Lab's efforts in increasing SPD not only came down to finding the best way to align the permanent magnets and the AMR beds, but also figuring out how much material they could cut down on and the best materials to use. The team's analysis projected that just by swapping gadolinium with LaFisai, the SPD shot up without even having to modify anything else. In their words, using LaFisai could allow MCHPs to become competitive with typical cooling devices up to 1 kilowatt of cooling power, leaving cost parity within reach. The Ames lab isn't done yet though. By the researchers' estimate, it'll be another 3 to 6 months before the performance evaluation for this iteration of their MCHP is complete. In the meantime, you can find researchers exploring magnetochlorics on the more commercial side in Europe. The French-German startup Magnoric, headquartered in Dubingheim and operating since 2019, is at work developing a refrigeration prototype. In October 2024, Magnoric debuted its magnetocaloric display cabinet at Chillventa, a heating and cooling tech trade fair. The company not only showed off that the refrigerator works, but proved its mettle by handing out cold drinks kept inside. In a press release for the event, Magnoric explained that it's now entering the pre-industrialization phase for larger units exceeding 6 kilowatts. These are for big use cases with high demand, like supermarkets and data centers. But even Magnoric itself is clear that as effective as magnetochlorics are, they're still in the research phase, though the company says industrialization is imminent. And that claim doesn't seem to be too far off because Magnoric isn't the only European company bringing magnetochloric refrigeration to the forefront. A short drive away from Magnoric's HQ lies Magnotherm in Darmstadt, Germany. Now, these two companies may share similar names and the same founding year, but what sets Magnotherm apart is its catalog. You can already get your hands on a magnetochloric chiller for a cool 6,500 euros, or about $7,000. Then there's the company's Eclipse model, a two-door glass case with clearly laid out specs. However, as you've probably noticed, both Magnotherm and Magnoric are targeting commercial industries. You can't exactly store your Thanksgiving turkey in Magnotherm's Polaris cooler, and the Eclipse, like Magnoric's prototype, is for large-scale applications, retail, hospitality, and medicine. That just goes back to the whole point of Ames Lab's research, determining the best way to make magnetocaloric devices cheaper and more compact, and therefore more practical. As of right now, cost is the age-old barrier to picking up a magnetic-powered fridge or heat pump at a hardware store. For those of you that have already seen our video on elastochlorics, you might still have a lingering question. Why invest in magnets? Research indicates that elastochlorics, specifically, have already beaten out magnetochlorics in terms of performance, sort of just by nature. It's easier to apply stress to something than it is to control a magnetic field. You also have to consider how permanent magnets are already highly sought after goods in the renewables industry alone, not to mention their other applications. As written in a 2023 paper on elastochlorics, magnetochloric materials and devices have been explored for almost 50 years, with kilowatt range cooling power refrigeration systems being demonstrated. Their high magnetic field requirement has, however, hampered commercialization. Of course, not everything elastic is fantastic. Magnoric's argument is that elastochlorics, while highly efficient and quiet, they have to contend with a more limited lifespan, at least until researchers figure out how to preserve or improve the durability of elastochloric materials. Stressing components further breaks them down, even when the cool results of that stress is what you want. We go in depth into these challenges in our first video and my follow-up interview with Dr. Ichiro Takeuchi from the University of Maryland about their work. I also have an interview with Dr. Julie Slaughter about her work on magnetochlorics. There's also the fact that elastochlorics are the baby of the solid-state cooling house. Interest in the tech is still very much new, especially when you compare it to its magnetic older sibling. By the time this video publishes, the International Elastochloric Society's second conference won't have even happened yet. So you could say that magnetochlorics have the maturity advantage here. At the end of the day though, any cooling device that can function without refrigerants is critical to the progress of the clean energy transition. It promises both better efficiency and fewer risks to human and environmental health. And if nothing else, the concept of solid-state cooling is real gas. But what do you think? Could magnetochlorox hold an iron grip on refrigeration someday? Or are MCHPs a little too polarizing for your taste? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined. We'll keep this conversation going. Thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support and helping to keep the channel going. Keep your mind open, stay curious, and I'll see you in the next one.